Vale, vamos a ver. Vamos a ver.
So in this lab, we learn about the pelvis, pelvic wall, or the radial pelvis. So mainly the bony pelvis. Okay. So this pelvis means it's a Latin word meaning a basin. You know, the wash basin where you wash your hands and all. So it exactly looks like this. Right?
Yeah.
So that's the meaning of pelvis in Latin word. So let's order the basin. So mainly formed of three bones. So you have two hip bones on either side. Okay? The one right hip bone and then the left hip bone. And behind you have this sacrum. Okay? Between the two hip bones you have the sacrum, okay, which is posterior side. So these two bones or three bones make a ring. Make a ring, right? So two hip bones on either side and the between and behind them is the sacrum. So forming a ring. So this forms the pelvis. So bones involved are two hip bones or also called the innominate bone and then the sacrum. And down to the sacrum you have even the a very small, there is the last part of it is the coccyx. So there is a the bones involved in the formation of the pelvis. So these two hip bones, they articulate and the anterior side. So before this, you know all that the hip bone consists of three parts, right? All of you know it. What are the three parts of the hip bone?
Ilium.
Yeah. So this is the ilium, the ischium, and then the pubis. So these are the three parts of the hip bone or the innominate bone. So the two pubis bones of both the hip bones, right and left, they unite in the anterior side. Outside, what it is called as pubic symphysis. Whereas posteriorly, the ilium of both the hip bones, okay, they articulate on either side of the sacrum, forming what we call it as the sacroiliac joints. That's how it forms a complete ring. So two joints are involved, or you can say three joints, two sacroiliac joints on the posterior side between the ilium and the sacrum, and anteriorly you have two pubic bones joining in pubic symphysis. So that's how there is complete ring formation, forming what we call it the pelvis. Yes.
Where are the pubis exactly?
This.
Okay.
This is the pubis.
Okay.
This is the ischium.
Okay.
This is the ilium.
Okay.
So two iliums, they're articulating with the sacrum,
okay,
forming sacroiliac joints.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm.
And the two pubic bones joining together to form the pubic symphysis.
Mm.
So that it forms a complete ring,
okay,
or what we call it the pelvis. So three joints, three bones. Two hip bones, right and left, in the sacrum, and the three joints are one pubic symphysis on the anterior side and two sacroiliac joints on the posterior side. Clear?
Yes.
Yes. So that's what I was saying about the hip bone or the pelvic bone. So we're having three parts of the ilium, ischium, and then the pubis. So now this pelvis, for obstetrical purpose, you know obstetrics? What is obstetrics? Yeah. What is obstetrics? So obstetrical purpose, this pelvis is divided into two parts. Divided into two parts. We call them as false pelvis and then the true pelvis. So what is false pelvis? So this we call it as the pelvic inlet, or also called as the pelvic brim. Pelvic brim or the pelvic inlet. We'll learn about that in detail. So pelvic brim and are also called as the pelvic inlet. And what are the part of the pelvis above this pelvic brim or the inlet is called as false pelvis, which doesn't have anterior boundary. False pelvis, it is open. It is open. And the same part of the pelvis which is below this pelvic brim is called as the true pelvis. It's called as the true pelvis. What are the two parts of the pelvis? True pelvis, where my hand is there, and this is the false pelvis. It doesn't have anterior bone.
Okay?
So above the pelvic inlet or the brim is the false pelvis, and below the pelvic inlet or the brim is the true pelvis. So
this is another classification of
just the class dividing the for our study actually we divide this study of the pelvis into dividing this pelvis into false pelvis and then the true pelvis. So the true pelvis only is having the obstacle importance compared to the false pelvis, which doesn't have any boundary and which doesn't involve in the what is called as the process of the delivery or the baby coming out through this passage. So it's only passed through the true pelvis, not the false pelvis. The false pelvis is the portion above the pelvic brim, as I said, and is not take part in the mechanism of delivery. So it doesn't have any obstetric importance. So before this actually going into the true pelvis or the inlet and all, so you should know about the anatomical position of the pelvis. And the pelvis in the body is not straight like this. It is slightly inclined. So making it about 120 degrees.
Like this.
Yeah. So actually even that is also not much this thing. Yeah. Okay. So it is slightly inclined forwards, making an angle of about 120 degrees. It's not straight like this, not like a basin. Okay, it's slightly inclined forwards, making an angle of 120 degrees. That is the anatomical position of the pelvis. Okay. I'll show you some pictures so that you will understand. So now, as we are not interested in the false pelvis as it doesn't have any obstacle importance, let's go to the true pelvis. As I said, true pelvis is below the pelvic brim or the pelvic inlet. So let's look into what is pelvic brim or pelvic inlet. Why we call it as inlet? Because this is the pelvic cavity. Any cavity will have an inlet and then an outlet, right? So inlets are also called as the pelvic brim. The margins of this pelvic brim or the pelvic inlet are formed by from the anterior side to posterior side. First, these are the pubic bones, the upper margins of your pubic bones, the anterior line. And then when you go posteriorly, this line is called as the iliopectineal line. What is this called as? Iliopectineal line. And the anterior margins of your ala of the sacrum.
Yeah.
These are the ala. Okay, and this is what we call it as sacral promontory. If you bring the separate sacrum, you will understand. This is called as the body of the sacrum, and these two are called as the ear-shaped structures, what we call it as the ala of the sacrum. What I am holding is the two alas of the sacrum, okay, and this is the body of the sacrum. And this sharp anterior margin of the body is called as sacral promontory. What is this called as? Sacral prominent, where it is prominating. Okay, so prominence or the sacral promontory, and these are the two anterior margins of your ala of the sacrum. So what are the boundaries of the pelvic inlet? Upper margin of your the two pubic bones, and then iliopectineal line, and then anterior border of the ala of the sacrum and sacral promontory. So the same on the other side also. So that forms the boundaries of your pelvic inlet. See here, pubic bone. This is what we call it as iliopectineal line. This line. This one. And this is the anterior margin of the ala of the sacrum, and this is the sacral promontory. The same on the other side.
Okay.
Ala of the sacrum. This is what is the iliopectineal line. Okay. Iliopectineal line. Pectineal line, ala of the sacrum, the sacral promontory.
This is from which side?
Yeah.
Which side, the sacrum? In the inferior?
Posterior. Can't you see? This is anterior. This is posterior. Anteriorly, anterior borders were both the pubic bones.
Mm-hmm.
Then iliopectineal line. Posteriorly, ala of the sacrum. And there is sacral promontory on the posterior side.
Okay.
Clear?
Clear.
Yes. So this is what, see in this picture you can see. So this is the anterior border of your, the upper border of your the pubic bone. Then you have the iliopectineal line, okay? And then ala of the sacrum, sacral promontory. Same again, ala of the sacrum, iliopectineal line, pubic bone. Clear?
Clear.
So that is the pelvic inlet or the pelvic
brim.
Then this is what is the cavity. This is what is the cavity. It forms the lateral boundaries of the cavity, and then posterior boundary is formed by the sacrum. Okay? And now the outlet. See this? From here to here, here to here. So there will be ligaments like this. Okay? So sacrum, what we call it, the tuberous ligaments. Sacro tuberous ligaments between the sacrum and then the ischial tuberosity, the sacral tuberous ligaments, okay, and then the tip of the coccyx, which is diamond shaped. Which is diamond shaped. You can see it here. These are two lines there. See here. Okay, and then like this, diamond shaped. Do you understand?
Yes.
The pelvic outlet. Pelvic outlet. So that is the boundaries are formed by the pubic bones, the ischium, ischial tuberous tuberosities, sacral tuberous ligament, which are not here. Okay, which are not here. From here, between this and this, there will be ligament, sacro tuberous ligaments. Then the coccyx, and then symphysis, pubic symphysis. So that forms the pelvic outlet, which is diamond shape. Diamond shape. Okay, so mainly the ischial tuberosities, they stand on the lateral side, from here and from here. Okay.
The ligaments are demonstrated as red lines.
Where?
Red lines on the picture. Those are the ligaments. Huh?
Yeah, yeah. Sacro tuberosities. Ischial tuberosities. This is the pubic symphysis. Sacro tuberous ligaments. So this resembles diamond shape, right? From here to here. Am I right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah? Diamond shaped outlet. Whereas almost round or oval shaped inlet. And between the outlet and the inlet, what you find is the cavity. So the cavity of the the true pelvis. True pelvis. So this is again one more picture showing mainly the inlet. This red line indicates the iliopectineal line. This is the L of the sacrum, this is the sacrum. And now the pelvic inlet. So I said same again, repetition of the same. Sacral, promontory, anterior, margins of the area of the sacrum. Linea terminal. The other name for iliopectineal line is the linea terminalis. Linea terminalis and upper ends of your pubic symphysis. So here, why, as I said, it is having optical importance? Because why?
It's correspond the uterus axis.
And very important is why? Because I am telling you, as these are bones, it forms the birth canal or the birth passage. The baby's head has to pass through this pelvic inlet, then pass through the cavity and then pass through the pelvic outlet to the exterior. So that's why these diameters, anterior posterior diameter, transverse diameter and oblique diameters, diameters of the inlet, diameters of the outlet, so they become very important. They become very important for the free passage of your the baby during delivery. So this becomes very important in obstetrics, especially when a lady comes to your, especially the primie. Primie means first time she is pregnant and about to deliver a baby. She comes to the obstetric clinic and then you have to assess very important, right, whether she is going to deliver the baby normally through the vagina or you have to take her to the cesarean section. You have to decide, right?
Yes.
So you cannot wait for her to continuously whether she will deliver or not. You cannot wait. You have to assess whether these diameters are enough for the easy passage of the baby's head or not. So usually you know baby's head diameters, fetal head diameters. And you should know the, because different women will have different types of pelvises. Sometimes the pelvis is not adequate for the easy passage of the baby through the birth canal. So then suddenly you can decide that she will not be able to go for vaginal delivery. Then you have to take her to the cesarean section. So that's how you decide and take her to the cesarean section, right? So that's why these diameters, they become very important for the obstetrician to assess whether she is going to have a vaginal delivery or she has to be taken for the cesarean section line. Okay? So that's why the study of these diameters, they become very important. So what are those diameters? As I said, three diameters. AP, that is anterior posterior diameter, also called the anatomical conjugate, from which we will calculate the obstetrical conjugate. Okay? And then oblique diameter. And then the transverse diameters. So these three diameters are very important. So AP diameter, what is that anterior posterior diameter? From where to where it extends? It extends from middle of the sacral promontory to the upper margin of the pubic symphysis. Where? Upper margin of the pubic symphysis to the middle of the sacral promontory.
Okay.
So that forms the anterior posterior diameter. It is about how much? So 11.3 to 13 point. What is that? 11.3 to around 11.5 centimeter.
From anterior to posterior?
Anterior to posterior. So if it is less, well, examination. So if it is less, then you can say that the she will not go for a normal delivery, then you have to take her to the
symphysis pubis. Is it the anterior or in the anterior or posterior?
What?
Symphysis pubis.
Upper border, I said. Upper border of the pubic symphysis till to the middle of the sacral promontor. I will come to that in the last slides. Okay. I will show you how to assess this diameter, how to check this diameter by vaginal examination.
The first two lines extend from middle of
middle sacral. Of the sacral promontory to the upper margin of the pubic symphysis here.
Okay.
Because this is the inlet. I am talking about the inlet. Inlet, anterior side you have formed by the upper margin of the pubic bones or the pubic symphysis, right?
Okay, yes.
So from here to middle of the sacral promontory.
Okay.
That forms the anterior posterior diameter. Okay. And then you have the oblique diameter, sacroiliac joint of one side to the iliopubic eminence of the other side, the opposite side. From here to here.
Yes, yes.
From here to here.
Okay.
Oblique diameter. This is what is iliopubic eminence.
Okay.
From here to here. That is the oblique diameter. So actually, you just forget this, you look into this, only at the pelvic brim.
Okay.
Okay. So these are the same diameters, but the measured are from different distances. Okay. So that is about 12.5 centimeter. And then you have the transverse diameter, the widest part from here. Okay. So this forms the transverse diameter, which is the maximum. That is 13.1. You are going to learn about all these obstacles important to the pelvis when you go to even your OBG classes. Okay. So these are the three diameters. What are the three diameters at the inlet?
Anterior
posterior diameter are also called as anatomical conjugate. This is a very important diameter because that is the smallest. If it is less than the normal, then she cannot have the normal delivery. Okay. So then oblique diameter and then transverse diameter. Because they are always more. So usually what is that? Those will be of adequate size for the passage of the safe passage of the head of the fetus or the baby. Okay. So only thing is, that is very less anterior posterior diameter, and that is the way the engagement of the head takes place. So that's why this diameter becomes very important. What is that? Anatomical conjugate. So even you should reduce around 1 centimeter from this to get the optical conjugate. Why I am telling this point is, see, you say the upper margin of the pubic symphysis from here.
Okay.
The pubis bone is also having some thickness.
Yeah.
Pubic bone is also having some thickness. So actual diameter becomes from here to here, inner side of the pubic symphysis, the baby's head.
Yeah.
Did you get that point? See, the pubic bone is having thickness. What we are taking the diameter is from upper margin to promontory. But now actually the head passes through inner surface of the pubic symphysis, right?
Okay.
So you have to minus around 1 centimeter from this anatomical conjugate to get the optical conjugate. But as you cannot exactly measure the from inner side to inner side in a lady, so you are first measuring the anatomical conjugate, because when you do the pervaginal examination like this, when you put your fingers, you can very easily assess from the pubic symphysis to this, you can touch the sacral promontory and then measure the distance. Okay. So now about the pelvic outlet. Pelvic outlet. So again, the same three diameters. So that is the anterior posterior diameter. And then you have the oblique diameter and then the transverse diameter. So here, the anterior posterior diameter, actually it is adjusting, because during the delivery, because of the release of the hormones like oxytocin and all, so this becomes slightly mobile. So outlet diameters are not of much importance compared to
inlet
diameter, because slightly movable. When the head passes through this, this is pushed posterior to the posterior side, so that
there will be increase in the diameters. Whereas inlet, as they are fixed bones, there is no movement or the stretching. So it becomes very important to assess the anterior posterior diameter at the inlet rather than at the outlet, because this coccyx will move little. Okay, so that is from the again lower part of the pubic symphysis to the tip of the coccyx. That becomes the anterior posterior diameter from here to here. See here, from here to here.
Okay.
Outlet. Okay, and then the transverse diameter and then the oblique diameter. So the three diameters at the outlet and three diameters at the inlet. See here, as I was talking to you, it is not straight, it is slightly inclined, the pelvis. Okay, so this forms the pelvic inlet, plane of the pelvic inlet, this forms the plane of pelvic outlet, so that there is curvature. The baby goes like this and bends and then comes out. It's not straight, it is inclined. So that goes inlet like this, the cavity, and then outlet. Got it? So this is the different planes, plane of the pelvic inlet and plane of the pelvic outlet. See here, the coccyx has shown slight movement.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, this is the outlet diameter. So this is in brief about the pelvis, bony pelvis. Okay, so what we talked about? We talked about the division or the bones forming the pelvis, bony pelvis, two hip bones or the innominate bones or the, and then the sacrum. Okay, then we studied about the division of the pelvis into false pelvis and then true pelvis. So true pelvis, again you have inlet, a cavity, and then outlet. So inlet formed by the upper margins of your both the pubic bones, then iliopectineal line, pubic bones, iliopectineal line or the linea terminalis, air of the sacrum, and then the sacral promontory. Okay, so that is about the inlet, or also called the pelvic brim, and even we studied about the diameters there. Okay, anterior posterior diameter or the anatomical conjugates, and then transverse diameter, and then oblique diameters. And similarly, the cavity, which is having the lateral walls formed mainly by the ischium bones, and the posterior wall by the sacrum and even the coccyx. And then the outlet, which is diamond shaped, formed by your ischiopubic ramus, the tip of the coccyx, ischial tuberosities, and sacrotuberous ligaments. It's a diamond shaped outlet. So this is also having again anterior posterior diameter, transverse diameter, and then
oblique
diameters. So now walls of the pelvis. Walls of the pelvis, the posterior wall. Posterior wall of the pelvis is formed by the sacrum. Okay? So last year you studied. What is the muscle here? Anterior surface of the which goes out of the greater sciatic foramen.
The gluteus maximus.
It's attached to the sacrum, which is called as the key muscle of the gluteal region. Key muscle of the gluteal region. It is the piriformis. Very good. So piriformis. So that forms the posterior wall of the pelvis, both sides. Okay, and either side you have the origin of the piriformis muscle. The piriformis muscle forms the posterior wall of the pelvis. Anterior to that, even you have the other like structures, the viscera's, like the rectum, the uterus, and even the urinary bladder, all those things. The wall of the pelvis is posteriorly, you have the piriformis muscle along with the vessels which are running downwards, vessels and nerves. And the lateral ones, I will show you in the, even in the, specimen. The lateral walls here, what is this foramen? Obturator foramen. Which muscle you find here? Obturator internus muscle. Obturator, lateral wall of the pelvis, I am telling. Inner side, the lateral wall of the pelvis is mainly found by your obturator internus muscle. And then ischiopubic ramus, both sides you have the attachment of levator ani muscle, which forms the floor of the pelvis. I will show you that. Floor of the pelvis is formed by levator ani muscles. We are interested in the walls, so posteriorly mainly your sacrum, we have the attachment to the piriformis muscle. Lateral wall of the obturator internus muscle. Along with that, you have the common iliac artery in the lateral wall dividing into external iliac and then internal iliac. Internal iliac again divides into anterior division, posterior division, giving different branches. And very important nerve which passes through on the lateral wall is your obturator nerve, which passes through obturator foramen and then comes out. or the anterior part of the thigh, supplying the muscles. So obturator nerve, obturator internus muscle, division of the common iliac into external and internal iliac artery. You can see there. See the obturator nerve. You can see even here the lateral wall of the pelvis. Okay, the common iliac dividing into internal and external iliac, which in turn divides into anterior and posterior divisions. And very important now, what you find here is the obturator nerve. These are the structures in the lateral wall of the pelvis. Lateral wall of the pelvis. Whereas floor is formed by the levator ani muscle. Levator ani muscle. So this forms the muscles in the walls of the pelvis. Posterior wall, piriformis, lateral wall, obturator internus muscle, along with other basal side nerves like common iliac dividing in internal iliac, then the obturator nerve. That is the same. One muscles in the pelvic wall are piriformis. See here, the cut section of the pelvis. One hip bone is taken out. The piriformis going out through the greater sciatic foramen. This is the obturator internus muscle. This forms the posterior wall and this forms the lateral wall. And this is what is the floor. Formed by all these muscles together, we call it as levator ani muscle, right? Levator ani muscle, different parts. So this is the levator ani muscle, which is covered by fascia, pelvic fascia. The floor, okay? So this is the levator ani muscle, covered by fascia, both on the upper side as well as the lower side. So now, different types of pelvis. So usually in females, you find, what is that? Gynecoid type of pelvis, where the normal delivery will happen. If she thinks that she is having this kind of android pelvis, then definitely she doesn't go for normal vaginal delivery. She has to be taken for cesarean section. And usually the males will have such kind of pelvis, android pelvis. Females will have gynecoid pelvis. Try to understand that in the diameters. In the diameter. See here. The transverse diameter is slightly almost proportional to each other, anterior, posterior and transverse diameter. Whereas here, the anterior, posterior is more, almost heart shape, or you can say oval shape like. And this is the platypoid. See here, almost flattened. Almost more transverse diameter compared to anterior, posterior diameter.
All normal,
not normal. So normal female will have, majority of the females will have this kind of pelvis, the gynecoid pelvis. If they have other than that, like android pelvis, she cannot. So now you can see it, many ladies going for your, what is that? The cesarean section, other than this cause. Maybe there are other causes, fetal distress and all, then also they will take her for cesarean section. I am talking about the anatomy of the pelvis. Because of the anatomy of the pelvis, if they are taking for cesarean sections, okay? But usually 60-70% will have the gynecoid type of pelvis, okay? So these are four different types of pelvis and the difference in the shape. Gynecoid, android, anthropoid and platypoid. See here again, huge difference between the transverse diameter and then the anterior posterior diameter. So four types of pelvis. What are they? Gynecoid, android, anthropoid and platypoid. So now again one more important a slide from your examination point of view, difference between male and female pelvis. This is all listed down, very easily you can follow. And now, here comes the some clinical aspects that I was talking to you about. What are the things you are supposed to assess when a lady comes to your clinic for the labor, in labor, labor pain. So then you have to assess for the assessment of, what is that, mobility of the sacrococcygeal joint, very important. So which enlarges the anterior posterior diameter of your the pelvic outlet. You have to assess that, whether it is mobile or not. Okay. And then assess interspinous diameter, different distance between the two ischial spines. See this, two ischial spines at the outlet. So where the transverse diameter is shortest there, this is the ischial spine. Okay, you have to do the vaginal examination and try to touch both the ischial spines with your two index fingers. Okay, so if you are able to touch, then it is less. By ischial spine diameter is less. So then she will face the difficulty in labor. Okay, so like that you should assess. And then spinotuberous distance. So that is from the outside. So and even assess intertuberous distance between the ischial tuberosities. two ischial tuberosities. Next slide is very important compared to this. So this is the vaginal examination, one what we are supposed to assess. So those three diameters, what I am saying is the diagonal conjugate, true conjugate and AP outlet. So true conjugate is also called as the optical conjugate. So I was talking to you about the thickness of the pubic bones. Okay. So this is how he is assessing the anterior posterior diameter. See here, this is the pubic symphysis, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And this time touch the sacral promontory. And now you have to minus from 1 to 1.5 centimeter from this. So that will get you the true conjugate. Okay. And then AP outlet, the anterior posterior diameter at the outlet. See this. And even you are assessing the mobility of the sacrococcygeal joint. So if it is mobile, then no problem. If it is not mobile, and if it is less, then again, so you will have complications in vaginal delivery. Okay?
Repeat.
Yeah?
Can you repeat?
What?
Vaginal examination
to assess those three diameters mainly. The diagonal conjugate, the true conjugate, and then the AP outlet. So that the anterior posterior diameter at the outlet. In that, true conjugate means, first you have to measure the anatomical conjugate, because you cannot put finger your inside the pubic symphysis, right? First you have to measure the anatomical conjugate. How will you measure that? You will measure like this. You are doing the procedure. See here, the thumb will adhere to the pubic symphysis outside, whereas you are touching the sacral promontory. So then baby's head is inside. You got it or not? See here, when I am doing the vaginal examination, you will put your finger like this. Okay, I am touching the sacral promontory. So now, I am measuring from here, outside to sacral promontory. But the baby's head will follow inside. This thickness you have to deduct.
Minus.
So when you deduct it, you will get the true conjugate. That is what we call it as obstetrical conjugate. When we are measuring it from the outside, then that is anatomical conjugate. Got it? So this diameter, especially this, see here, how the baby's head, this is what is inlet, sacral promontory and the pubic symphysis. The way the baby's head it passes through, that's why these two, as they are immobile, so this becomes very important. This diameter, that is true conjugate or the obstetrical conjugate, becomes very important, so that the baby's head will pass through the birth canal. Okay, so this is the engagement of the baby's head, we call it as. That is called as examining. So you will one hand you will be holding the baby's head and other the pelvis, and you will try to move that baby's head. If it is moving, then it is not engaged. If it is not moving, then we say that already it is engaged. So that you will have the normal passage like that. So that is the assessment methods of whether she will go for normal vaginal delivery or we have to take her to the OT for cesarean section. These are the slides of clinical importance. So you learn it again when you go to your OBG classes. Okay. So that's all about the pelvis, bony pelvis, and then the pelvic wall.